Should I just try it? Should I just swing my arm right through? You didn't think I was actually gonna show you that in the first 5 seconds of the video. Don't worry, it does happen though. So in case you've been living under a rock, Disney recently announced that they've created the world's first retractable lightsaber. Which is kind of strange considering I have this certificate right here from last year. Okay, so ours is still technically a proto-lightsaber since it requires a backpack. But we are actually working on a newer version that might just be fully self-contained in the hilt. But more on that later. So has Disney really made a real working, fully in the handle, gosh darn laser beaming plasma cutting lightsaber? Well, probably not. It's actually probably similar to the toy lightsabers that I grew up with. In fact, they actually filed a patent a few years ago about it. But of course, patents are always a little confusing to read, and if you're looking at this with an untrained eye, you might be like, yeah, this is a lightsaber. Cool. But if you look a bit closer, it's pretty obvious it won't be cutting through anything anytime soon. Luckily, Ben Ridout on Twitter created an animation that kind of explains the rough concept of this patent, and it's pretty cool. I just hope the LEDs they're using are super bright, because if they are, it will be the most realistic and coolest extendable prop lightsaber on the market. Anyway, let's talk about the closest thing to a real lightsaber on the market. Well, I guess it's not really on the market since we're not willing to sell it, but... I'm talking about our current proto-saber. In celebration of May the 4th be with you, we thought this would be a good time to answer a few more questions about our lightsaber and maybe try a few new tests, including putting a hand through it, which we'll do at some point in this video. Our original lightsaber video is now our fourth most viewed video on the channel with over 31 million views. That's absolutely insane. If you add up all the views of all our lightsaber videos, it's over 100 million views. You guys must like lightsabers or something. So let's take a deep dive and talk a bit more about how this actually works, what it can and can't do, and touch on how we're gonna make it better for the future. As we mentioned in the build video, the basic principle of our proto-saber is burning a mixture of laminar flow gas. In this case, propane and oxygen. It's not creating pure plasma, but there is a certain amount of plasma in the burning blade. What makes it possible is the laminar flow nozzle, which is from GTT, Glass Torch Technologies. That's right, the secret to our proto-saber is a piece of tech that's been around for decades. And I guarantee anyone who's ever used or seen a glass blowing torch has probably waved it around humming lightsaber sounds. The cool thing is, we're actually going to be working with GTT to develop a new type of torch more suitable for our lightsaber-like application, which might just be the key in being able to make one of these fully cordless. Maybe. Either way, make sure you subscribe. So what are the biggest issues with our design? Well, for starters, it's a proto-saber, and having a cord is kinda lame. But we've explained in past episodes, one of the biggest issues with a real lightsaber is getting enough energy into such a small hilt. It's just one of those things that, you know, is limited by our technology of the time. Maybe someday, though. The other big issue that lots of people pointed out is how the length of the blade kind of varies. Since it is a torch flame, it's susceptible to having its gas flow disrupted, like this. When it's pointed straight up, we can get a blade length of almost 3 feet or around 100 centimeters. But when moved fast, the blade can shrink down to a foot or about 30 centimeters, making swinging a lightsaber around kind of difficult. Now the thing I'm curious about is, if it's air resistance that causes this, what if I use this lightsaber in outer space? I'm probably not going to be able to try that anytime soon, but what if I could test it out in a large enough vacuum chamber? Hypothetically, since this lightsaber provides its own oxygen, it doesn't need air to work. And if it's the surrounding air that's causing this disruption of gas, you might be able to swing this around in a vacuum chamber without the blade changing at all, which would be really cool. The issue is, where do we find a giant vacuum chamber that we can put this in? Besides, like, NASA. Seriously, if any of you guys know of a vacuum chamber that this could be tested in, let us know and send us an email at contact@thehacksmith.com. A lot of people also asked what our lightsaber sounds like without any added lightsaber sounds. And well, this is what it sounds like. It basically sounds like a louder version of a mini saber blowtorch. Which honestly is probably what a real lightsaber would sound like. If a real lightsaber is in fact plasma, it would make some noises not unlike that. If a real lightsaber is in fact a laser, well, it probably wouldn't make any sounds at all. Okay, now what about cutting power? In the movies, lightsabers can swing quickly through things, cutting them instantly. Unfortunately, in real life, we have to deal with a branch of physics called thermodynamics, specifically heat transfer. Have I lost you yet? Let's start with a basic example. Take a tea kettle, for instance. Water boils at 100 degrees Celsius. A tea kettle heating element can heat up to 100 degrees Celsius. But water doesn't just boil instantly when you turn on the kettle, or when you blast fire. You see, it takes a few minutes. That's because the heat created from the element needs to transfer into the water in order to heat it up. Or in the case of a lightsaber, how long does it take for the heat from the lightsaber to heat up the material to its melting point, at which point it would start to cut? So, how do we figure out how long that takes? Using specific heat capacity. The specific heat capacity of material is the energy required to raise 1 kilogram of the material by 1 degree Celsius. The specific heat capacity of water is about 4,180 joules per kilogram Celsius. A watt is a joule per second. So how long does it take to boil water? Well, let's try out the calculation. If we take 1 kilogram of water, which would be 1 liter since water is a kilogram per liter in density, and it has a specific heat capacity of 4,180 joules per kilogram Celsius, we want it to hit 100 degrees Celsius and it starts at room temperature, or about 20 degrees. Therefore, the calculation is 1 kilogram times 4,180 times 80 degrees Celsius, which equals 334,400 joules, which means in order to have a kettle boil a liter of water in just 1 second, you would need 334.4 kilowatts of heating power. Remember, the average North American home only has about 48 kilowatts of power for the entire house. Luckily, no one needs to boil water instantly. Even our original tungsten titanium proto lightsaber, which was essentially a giant 20 kilowatt heating element, well, it would take that 16.7 seconds to boil a liter of water. It's fast, but it's definitely not instant. So if you want to boil a liter of water in a minute, we can divide this total power by 60 seconds, which will only be 5.56 kilowatts. Quite a bit more reasonable. But the average kettle is only 1.5 kilowatts because of the limitation from an outlet. At 1.5 kilowatts of heating power, it would take the average kettle about 3.71 minutes to boil an entire kilogram of water. So yeah, it takes a while to heat things up. Luckily, water actually has a really, really, really high specific heat capacity. While water is around 4,200, steel is only 420, or a tenth of water. That's great, right? That means you can slice through a wall of steel 10 times faster than boiling a wall of water, right? That doesn't even make any sense. Anyway, the too long didn't listen to my physics explanation is it takes a long time to transfer heat into an object, or cut an object with a lightsaber. The only things we can control to speed it up is the temperature of the lightsaber, or the melting point of the material, or the amount of material. So yeah, we can cut through a sheet of thin lead quite quickly since it has a lower melting point than steel, but there's less material to heat up, and it's not steel. So the real question is, how hot could we get a lightsaber?
Well, I'm off. I'll be back in a couple days.
What? Where are you going?
I'm going to Japan.
Japan?
Anime.
What?
Those like Japanese cartoons. Have you?
I know what anime is, Owen. Why are you going to Japan?
Well, because they have stuff on Netflix that we don't have here. I can't get it here.
Are you kidding me?
What?
Just install NordVPN on whatever device you're using for streaming, whether it's a computer, your phone, or a laptop.
What's a VPN? Is that some type of like anime streaming service? I've never heard of it.
It's a VPN, a virtual private network. It's super simple, one click, that's all. Open the map, click on a location, and you'll be connected in seconds. It's that easy. You'll have access to all the Netflix content available in Japan or in over 50 countries without leaving home.
Damn, I already got a ticket though. Is it fast? Because I hate chunky video.
It's the fastest VPN out there, and it also offers a cool anti-malware tool called CyberSec. You can be in Japan on your phone while you're on the bus on your way home, while even protecting yourself from hackers and bad people trying to read your sensitive information. I heard the Wi-Fi on those buses aren't so safe, man. And that goes for you guys too. Visit NordVPN using my link below or use the coupon code HACKSMITH during checkout for a huge discount on NordVPN, plus one extra month for free. They offer a 30-day money-back guarantee and they're doing their final sale at the moment, so get going. And you, get back to work. So how hot could we get our lightsaber? Our current saber clocks in at an impressive 2200 Celsius, or about 4000 Fahrenheit, using the current fuel mixture. An acetylene torch can hit about 6200 Fahrenheit, or 3500 Celsius, which is hotter than most materials' melting points. Unfortunately, there are some challenges in running oxyacetylene in a torch like this, which is why we use propane instead. Anyway, the issue is, even at those massive temperatures, we still need to take into account heat transfer. A focused oxyacetylene torch can cut through steel plate fairly quickly, but part of the reason that works is because a cutting torch is good at cutting. it's because it has a very thin blade, which means it only needs to heat up a small amount of material, which means it can cut things a lot faster. Even though our lightsaber is hella hot, it's got a big blade, and that means the heat isn't very focused when cutting things. It has to heat up a lot of material before it can start cutting. And unfortunately, that's just the reality of lightsaber physics. In fact, the only time lightsabers were portrayed in a reasonable way was when Qui-Gon Jinn cut through the blast shield doors. It actually showed that it took time to heat up that much durasteel in order to cut through, even though every other depiction of a lightsaber shows it either cutting through things instantly, or in the case of Beskar, not at all. Our lightsaber could cut through a few inches of steel plate. It'd just take a really, really, really long time. If we wanted to be able to slice through things and cut metal just like the movies, I'd guess that our lightsaber would have to be in excess of 20,000 degrees Celsius, aka 4 times hotter than the surface of the sun. We could even do some calculations with our handy dandy specific heat transfer equation, but why bother? If the blade is 20,000 degrees Celsius, you wouldn't even be able to hold the lightsaber. Okay, back to our other lightsaber questions. Lots of you guys asked if it would be possible to put some kind of solid blade inside of our lightsaber so it could actually deflect into the lightsaber. Now that could work, but the issue is most materials that are capable of withstanding this heat are also rather brittle, which means it might work, but you'd still have to gently hit lightsabers against each other, which is also kind of lame. A lot of people also asked, what would happen if you shot a bullet through the lightsaber? Would the bullet melt? Well, no. No, it wouldn't. And again, we can thank heat transfer for the answer. Since a bullet would be moving super fast through the blade, I would guess that it wouldn't even warm up because it spends so little time inside of the heat source. But hey, let's prove it. I'm going to use a Nerf gun for our demonstration though. Now, a Nerf dart has a very, 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 very low melting point, and it travels a lot slower than a bullet. So, first off, let's see what happens if we put this into the lightsaber. Woo! And it's gone. Now that happened pretty quick, but the question is, what if I shoot the Nerf dart? Not even warm. And that's heat transfer for you. Because it moves so quickly, it didn't actually take on much heat from the lightsaber. I guess lightsabers aren't actually very good at deflecting things, or even melting things. Cut. All right, that was kind of disappointing, but was to be expected. So let's get to the real meat and potatoes of this video. The reason you clicked on this video. Would this lightsaber cut off my hand? Should I just try it? Should I just swing my arm right through? So like we learned, as long as I can minimize my hand's time inside the lightsaber blade, hypothetically, I won't cut my hand off. My skin and body have their own specific heat capacities, though the human body's ability to self-regulate temperatures kind of changes that. It takes a long time, obviously. A dead hand might actually be a more scientific test, maybe. Yeah, it's a box of hands. In all seriousness, though, these are actually wax hands from Ripley's Believe It or Not Museum in Orlando. Big thank you to Curtis to sending these to us for a lightsaber test, which, well, you get your wish. We're gonna see what happens. So. All right. Okay, for the first test, we're gonna slowly put this hand through and see what happens. Woo! That still takes a while, but that would most certainly be a third degree burn, or a fourth degree burn. Is there such a thing as a fifth degree burn? It definitely burns the hand, but what if we swung the hand through quickly? And this one has hair in it. So let's see what happens if I swing this through the lightsaber really quickly. Is it gonna heat up? Is it gonna melt at all? And depending on the result, is that gonna give me the confidence required to swing my own hand through the lightsaber? Here we go, karate chopping a lightsaber. Not even warm. Let's do it upside down, see if we can burn some of these hairs off. Even the hair? All right, so this can't be overstated. Do not try this at home. I am a trained professional idiot, and yeah, based on my calculations, everything should be fine. You guys ready? That was awesome. Did you see how the flame wrapped around my hand and through my fingers? And I didn't even get burnt. That's because the time my hand spent in the actual fire wasn't long enough for the heat to transfer into my skin. Regardless, do not try that at home. Don't try sticking your hand in fire just to see if you can. If you end up holding it in for just a bit too long, you could end up with serious burns. This was a risk. It was a calculated risk on my part, and I'm a trained professional, but don't try this at home. Hope you guys enjoyed this video and maybe learned a thing or two about physics. We're gonna keep working on our lightsaber technology, so make sure you subscribe because our next version of this, well, maybe not the next version, we're gonna try and make it fully cordless, which would be really cool. And also, make sure you keep your eyes peeled at hacksmith.store because we're releasing our very own mini saber. Thanks for watching, guys.